We're here to worship God this morning. We sing His praises. Let's wake up. Come on, come on, let's worship.
Come, let us worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He has done a great thing. See what our Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things.
Come
on. Oh, hero of heaven, You conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, You have done great things. We dance in Your freedom, awaken to life. Oh Jesus, our Savior, Your name lifted high. Oh God, You have done great things.
Let's get excited to sing His praises this morning. That's why we're here. We're here to sing His name.
You've been faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things.
And I know.
And I know You will do it again. For Your promise is yes and amen. You do great things.
He's our hero.
Oh, hero of heaven, You conquer the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh God, You have done great things. We dance in Your freedom, awaken to life. Oh Jesus, our Savior, Your name lifted high. Oh God, You have done great things.
Come on, we're gonna shout hallelujah. He's above it.
Hallelujah, God, above it all. Hallelujah, God, unshakable. Hallelujah, You have done great things.
Come on, every voice, sing hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah, God. Above it all, hallelujah, God, unshakable, hallelujah, You have done great things, You've done great things.
Oh, hero of heaven, You conquer the grave, You free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God,
You have done great things. Your freedom awakens alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, Your name lifted high. Oh God, You have done great.
You've done, You've done.
You have done great things. Oh God, You have done great.
God fights for us. He is the one who keeps us safe. Come on, let's sing about His name. He is our mighty warrior.
He calls us, come on. He called us out from the depths into Your freedom. Our chains are shall prevail. Your word is stronger. We overcome.
Do you believe that this morning? Come on. place. Let's sing together.
Your glory resounds through the age. All saints declaring your great renown. Your kingdom forever will stand.
No more.
We won't be shaken. We will not.
Come on, he's our God.
Our God, a mighty warrior, you're all consuming fire. In victory you reign, we triumph in your name. Jesus, the great commander, you conquered death forever. In victory you reign, we triumph in you.
Sing it again.
Our God, a mighty warrior, you're all consuming fire. Victory you made, we triumph in your name. Jesus, the great commander, you conquered death forever. In victory you made, we triumph in your name.
We declare,
and we declare, your name is found.
Come on, let's shut it up. He's our God.
Lord our God is ever faithful, never changing through the ages. From this darkness you will lead us, and forever we will say, you're the Lord our God.
Go on, let's be his feet. Let's be his feet. We won't move without you. We won't move without you. You're the light of all and all that we need. We won't move without you. We won't move without you. You're the light of all and all that we need, yeah.
We won't move without you. We won't move without you. You're the light of all and all that we need.
One more time.
We won't move without you. We won't move without you. You're the light of all.
Pray with me. Lord, I'm humbled this morning, Lord, to just be here. God, to, as we begin to dive into this series that you've put on many of our hearts, Lord, it's not going to be the easiest thing to hear necessarily. But it's what you've called us to. And I pray for each and every one of us right now, God, that you would that you would open our hearts, that you would open our minds. God, that you would help us. God, that you would guide us, that you would speak through me with exactly what it is you want to say, not what I want to say. Lord, thank you. Thank you for your presence. Thank you, God, for the ability to just be here together as a church. God, you've got great things in store for us. But Lord, we got some work to do as well. So God, I pray you would guide our steps and help us. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
Still not good enough. Good morning. There we go. Now we're getting better. Like, I'm going to be calm today. Some of you are laughing, like, there's no chance of that happening. This series that we're kicking off, We Are That Church, it's a different series, probably than any series you, may have been a part of. And it's a series kind of like where you and I, we're a family. You remember me telling you a few weeks ago, like, I'm your new redheaded cousin, like, I'm weird. And but I feel like there's so much that God wants to do through us that we need to take some time as a family and look at not just why, but how we're going to go about being that church. Because that's what this country needs. You understand that, right? This world, this county, this city that we're in, it needs you and me to be that church. But in order for us to be that church, we've got to make sure that we're on the same page. And I want to make sure that through this series, you and I get on the same page. And I'm going to go ahead and say this. If you've got a pen and paper handy, you're going to want to write stuff down. The first thing you're going to want to write down is my email address, which is jcamp@cccpeople.com. Because there's going to be some things that I'm going to say, that I'm going to challenge you with, that you're probably not going to like. And I want to just encourage you to remember, Sunday at church is not where we talk about things you may not like. Okay? Email me. Call the office. Let's just get together. Let's have a cup of coffee. Because some of the things that I'm going to be sharing are going to, they're going to get you uncomfortable. They're going to challenge you. And I hope through the entire thing that you guys see my heart in this. Even up to this morning, I have been praying and wrestling with exactly where God wants not just us as a church to go, but seeing some things that we need to address along the way. So this is kind of like that family meeting. But here's the good news, okay? We are going to have some fun through it. Some of you are sitting there going, oh Lord, what is about to happen? So we're going to have some fun. But my heart and my hope is that as we go through this series, that you guys get to know me a little bit, that you get to understand me a little bit. Because you understand something, right? Like 10% is this stage. I hope you know that. 10% of me is this stage. There's so much more to me than just being up here and sharing God's word. There's so much more to who I am and how God works through me. And I hope that through this series, you and I get to know one another a little bit better, okay? And so I ask that if you would, do me a favor and not throw tomatoes right off the bat, okay? And not get too fired up. But this series, I had in my mind going a different direction until the other night when Michelle and I were traveling back from Ohio. And our kids actually fell asleep early, and her and I actually got to talk. Like, it's amazing when that happens. And some of you who have kids our age, you're like, yo, I know what that's all about. We, like, literally got to just talk. And as we were talking, and I was sharing with her about this series and what I'm hoping to do, you know, I kind of had it in my mind that we're going to just get people fired up, and we're going to get ready to go be that church. But as Michelle and I were talking, she began to say, you know, Joe, it's not that I sense in our church that they're not ready to go. It's that they're not 100% sure how to go. And so she changed my mind a little bit in that. Like that dream that's coming into reality a little bit. You wake up and it's like, oh, it's really happening. And so I'm excited. But I'm not just here to be a great church. I hope you know that. I'm excited that we're a great church. But the way God has wired me is that he's given me a passion for excellence. And so while we're a great church, it's not enough for me. It shouldn't be enough for you. We should want to be an excellent church. Because as you'll see at the end of this, it's not just about us and why we have to be an excellent church. There's so many more people that are depending on you and I to go from great to excellent. And I hope that you guys hear my heart through this. This is how God is. He's wired me to strive like this. I want to see and achieve a level of excellence for God's glory. And it's actually, you're going to hear some things today that are going to make you go, wow, dude, where did you come from? And there's going to be some things that you're going to get excited about. But at the same time, I want to make sure that you guys understand all of what we're going to be doing over the next 4 weeks is we're going to be looking at four things that are going to take us to a level of excellence that I feel God has for each and every one of us. And those four things are, I actually did it in M's, so that makes it really easy. I like it when it just flows right, you know. Even if I have to make up a word. Like, I'm kidding. But man, I want to, so there's four areas that we're going to be looking at. And the four areas are us meeting together. That's what we do here, meeting together. The second one is making mature believers. The third week is multiplying in our community, the third goal. But today I want to start with something that's extremely important to me, and that is the fourth thing, which is managing what God has given us. Managing what God has given us. And so I actually have like notes up here today. I normally don't do notes, just so you guys probably realize that by now, I would imagine. But let me put this thing down here. Listen, if I get a shock from this, you'll know I'm not used to this. But I really want to make sure, you know, you guys, you know, hear my heart through this series. And I want to say some things. And what I want to do is make sure you understand scripturally, first of all, where I'm coming from. In the book of Acts, chapter 2, God does some really amazing things. And it's kind of that beginning of the church. There was about 120 people, and God like did some amazing things, and all of a sudden he gave them a 3,000 like increase, and it was insane what God was doing. But right at the end of Acts 2, there's some scripture right after that, and it's just a small section. And specifically today, I want to talk about Acts 2:44. Okay, and so I'm going to read it to you. It's going to be up on the screens, and it says this: all the believers were together and had everything in common. That is where I'm coming from for the basis of today. Managing what God has blessed us with. Do you see that verse? They were all together. Hey, guess what? We're all together. And they had everything in common. And I think we have everything in common, but thinking is not enough. We've got to get everything in common. And so as we go through, I hope you hear my heart through this whole thing. And I want to share some things that are kind of personal to me as we get ready to kind of go down through this, this passage in this series. I want to share some things that I've seen, that I've experienced, that I've been a part of that, you know, you may look and go, wow. And the first thing is this, and I want to make a couple general statements. I know this is absolutely different than what you guys are used to. This effort, I want to make sure you understand as we go and why we're doing this series, is because you need to be on the same page. Every one of us. We need to be on the same page. That's what that scripture is talking about. And I would say we are probably already on the same page, but this series is to make sure that we're staying on the same page, because I don't know if you know exactly what is going on in your church right now. And I want to talk about kind of the last 8 or 9 weeks if I can. It is vital that you and I begin to get better at managing what God has blessed us with. And here's why. Over the last 8 weeks, we have seen a large, large increase in people coming to our church, which is great, right? Like, you guys should like clap, like, or something. Like, let me know you're there. Like, because God is doing something, and it's palpable. It's there. There's something going on that I don't know if it's in the water or what. I'm guessing it's probably His Spirit just working through us as a church. But God is beginning to do something, and it's not just a normal increase. Like literally, you know, when I got here 8 or 9 weeks ago, it was between 280 and 300 people would come. Now, over the last 8 weeks, we've actually been around the 450 mark. Okay, and here's the funny thing. We didn't really do anything different. And so that just tells you that God is up to something. But when God is up to something, you and I have a responsibility as the church. We have a responsibility as a church to be able to do this. And so this series is taking place because I wanted in my heart to make sure you understand something. You will always be communicated to, and we will always be on the same page together as a church family, as long as I'm here. You will never get a half-truth or a polished answer from me. I want to set this standard right now. I have seen it time and again in churches in America where some things happen and churches go through difficult times and they try to, you know, deliver an answer in regards to what's easiest for the church to handle. If you are looking for a person to be soft, if you are looking for a nice, cuddly answer that makes you feel good about your life, you have the wrong guy. Because I'm here to do exactly what God tells us that we as a church are going to do. And I want to set that standard because I want to make sure you guys, as we get ready to go through this, that you guys see and hear my heart, we're going to go through some difficult things. You all as a church have already been through some difficult things. But I want to make sure you know I will communicate to you clearly the truth of everything that takes place. If you've got questions, come and ask them. We're going to set that standard from right on out because that's the best way that we as a church can manage what God has blessed us with. And it's not always easy. Okay, we know that. There have been things, and even some things today I'm going to talk about that are going to get you a little itchy, a little uncomfortable. That's why I gave you my email address at first. Before you decide this isn't for me and you want a jet, come have coffee with me, okay? And let's talk because I want you to hear my heart through some of these things. We're going to get better at managing what God has given us with. And how we're going to do that is it starts with a cuss word for churches. And many of you are going, what word is it? It's probably not the word you're thinking of. See what I did there? It was like, boom. Anyway, the word is change. It's a cuss word in a lot of churches. That's why a lot of churches are dying. It's because they refuse to change. And listen, we're going to do some things differently. We're going to change some things. We're going to head in a direction that I know God has put on my heart and the elders' heart and the leadership's heart that has been here that for years. Even I'm just blessed to be a part of it. But we're going to go through some change. And I want to make sure you're with me. I want to make sure you understand why, how, and what the heck we're going to be doing. Because if we don't do that, if we don't communicate to you effectively why we're doing certain things, we fail you. And I'm not going to let that happen. And so I want to make sure that you understand that before you throw that tomato that you've got tucked under your seat, okay, I want to make sure you understand a little bit about me and why we're kind of going to be heading this way, okay? The first thing, a couple of things I want to make sure you know about me. One, I have a huge passion for the local church. That's us, just so you know. If you haven't picked up on that yet, I don't know where you've been, okay? It's okay. But the other thing that I have a huge passion for is leadership. The number one thing that I love is when the local church and leadership come together. It's the most beautiful thing I have ever seen. And I can get up here and say we've been building leaders or we've not been building leaders very well, or I'm not even going to go there yet. All I'm telling you is know in my heart that I love the local church, I love leadership, and whatever I'm up to, it's usually got one of those two things involved, unless it's my kids, okay? And then I have no idea what I'm up to. But I got here about 8 or 9 weeks ago, and I quickly began to assess some things that we need to change a little bit, okay? And then again, this is a different type of series. This is a family meeting of sorts, okay? And one of the first things that I needed to that I realized quickly was that we as a church, because God has been blessing, we've kind of outgrown our structure. Okay? A structure is how we work and operate with each other, and we kind of outgrew that. And not too long ago, I was sharing with our elders, and I shared with them a game plan of a new structure that will not only get us to where we need to be, but also sustain us for the future. Again, this is a passion of mine. This is why I study organizational leadership, is because when you bring it together with the church, it's incredible. It's a beautiful, beautiful picture, and I truly believe that it's huge. And as you begin to think about the concept of managing what God has blessed us with, when you outgrow your structure, it feels like you really don't know what's going on. Have you ever felt that? I mean, be honest. You're like, what is really happening here? And so it's a lot of that is due because we've outgrown our structure. Listen, not only you had outgrown your structure before I'd even gotten here, like literally. And so I have and am going to show and share with you the new structure as a church that we're going to go with. And there's some things that we're going to do. So they're going to put it up on the screens, okay? And you will see in this new structure, managing, four words in the middle, managing, making, meeting, and multiplying. That's this series, just so you know. See how I did that? Like, all right. The first thing I want to share with you guys through this new structure, and they're going to leave it up for a little bit so you can kind of look at it, is you're looking at it going, well, wait a minute. Why is it not a top-down structure? Like, what's the hierarchy? I want to go ahead and say something to each and every one of you right now. This is all about team leadership. If you look, you will begin to see different teams that are moving throughout. And this is kind of the early phase, okay, of where we're at. This is going to bring us current, and then we've got things that we're going to be launching out that we're going to talk about over the next few weeks. But if you will notice, around me is a team of people. Why did I do that? Stop looking up there and look at me really quickly because I want to make sure we make eye contact on this. This is not about me. This is not about Joe Camp. This is not about me. This is about what God wants to accomplish through all of us. And together, as a team, we will operate and move through what God wants us to have. I want you to hear me on that. If you get on social media and you hashtag, I love my pastor, or hashtag, I love my church, I am going to be all over you. Because this is not about me. This is not about us. This is about the Father and what Christ wants to do through us. And so from this point onward, I want you to see this is how this is built. I have a team of people around me. I will move through them, and they have a team of people around them, and so on and so on and so on. We will branch out into teams. And as many of you are sitting there going, well, that's pretty cool. Why do I need to know this? Because I expect at some point in time for each and every one of you to step and be a part of a team. Well, I know that it's nice to just show up on Sundays for church. But church is so much more than just Sunday. Do you understand that? I'm not going to stand up here and beg and plead for your help. I don't even have to tell you that God has called you to step up and be a part of the church and to do something. You can go to the Bible and find that. I don't need to tell you that. But at some point in time, each and every one of you, okay, you're going to see that there's going to be an opportunity for you to step in and use how God has gifted you specifically. This structure is going to enable that to happen. So if you have had God speak to you and you've wanted to start something, but you don't know where to begin, you're like, oh, I don't know where to begin. That's because we outgrew our structure. Now, if God puts something on your heart and you feel empowered that you want to accomplish something, there's something he's calling you to, now we have a place, we have an area where you can step in and begin to lead and become the leader that God has called you to be. I'm sharing this with you because I told you what? We will always be on the same page. We've got to get better at managing what God has given us, and this is going to help us to be able to do that, okay? The awesome thing I want to make sure you understand about having a team of people around me is guess what? Because it's not about me, it's about a team of people around me and with me, they get to hold me accountable. I am huge on accountability. You should hold me accountable. I should hold you accountable. There should be a system set up to where we're holding one another accountable. That way, I can't just go do what I want to do for fun for the church because I think it looks great. That way we don't take and I say, you know what, guys, we're putting in a new baptism and it's a giant water slide outside. Okay? There is a team of people that are around me that are gonna go, hey, easy. Okay? I don't think that's correct. I'm not saying it's not biblical. Yeah, I haven't really kind of put the evidence down on the water slide as much. But there's a team of people around me, and I want to let you know that team, and we're going to go through them as the weeks, but I feel like I need to do this because Pastor Steve is going to be leaving at the end of the month for a couple of weeks, him and Debbie are. And so I want to make sure you understand the team around me, the person that kind of is going to be spearheading, helping us manage what God has given us better is Kevin Smith. Many of you know him. If you don't know him, just look for the guy that has a lot less hair than I do, and he's a lot taller. And so he's awesome. And I don't know if he's here. I don't see him in here yet. So he's probably going to attend second. But that he will kind of be as a operations guide to help us guide, okay? The other person that's going to help us, obviously, you know him well, and that's Pastor Scotty. I've asked Pastor Scotty to step up and to be not only our worship pastor, our executive pastor as well, because he and I have an alignment together that we truly, there's just it's an odd connection, you know what I mean? We're like the odd couples. And it really, the decision was based off his beard. I'm kidding, okay? I'm kidding. And then leading our entire ministry area for making mature believers, obviously you know his gifting and his heart, and that's Pastor Steve. While I'm talking about Pastor Steve really quickly, and I need to pick up the pace because we got a lot to cover, I just want to say, and you all, every one of you in this church, you better be thankful for what Pastor Steve has done over the last couple of years, getting you healthy, getting you ready for change. Him and Debbie have poured their hearts and souls into you, and they've righted the ship. And so I'm humbled because I get to come in, and I didn't see a lot of that because of the hard work that he did. And so he's going to be breaking it down. And so week three of this series, we're going to be looking at his ministry area and how you can be a part and what steps we're going to be doing to get better at that. And then our fourth area, I've asked Jessica Pape, she's right there if you don't know her, to step up and to lead us to multiplying in our communities. Jessica, if you don't know, is the executive director of the Chamber of Commerce here in Manchester. In other words, she's got the connections to the community that we have yet to impact. So she's, yeah, it got quiet in here when I said that, you know what I mean? But I'm excited because she's going to help us begin to bridge getting outside of this building and getting into our community the way that we need to, okay? So now, to do this, we have this overarching thing. I want to just take a moment. That's my team. I want to share this. I want to ask you a question because this is going to tell me a lot. How many of you know the vision of our church? If you know the vision of our church, say it out loud right now. Steve, I got him again, didn't I? It's so awesome. It's a trick question. That's our mission. Right? Isn't that awesome? So when I got here, you guys have an amazing mission. And I want to say this. It is amazing that you all know that. That's huge. It actually warms my heart because there's a lot of churches in America that have no clue what their church's vision or mission is. And when I got here, I realized that quickly, that we have a great mission, but we don't necessarily have an overarching vision for what we're trying to accomplish. And so I want to go ahead and put that up on the screens for you guys right now. Our overarching vision is we're going to be changing communities for Christ one life at a time. Okay? One life at a time. We're going to change our communities. And notice I said communities. I did not say community. Because there are little towns all over, many of you live in them, that they need the love of Christ. And that's, if you put the two together, helping people know and grow in the love of Christ, that's our mission, okay? Our mission is to help people know and grow in the love of Christ. Listen, if you put the two together, you'll realize the vision is kind of where we're going. We're going to go change communities for Christ one life at a time. The how is by helping people know and grow in the love of Christ, okay? That is imperative, okay? That is kind of the game plan. However, and this is where we get to the fun part, all right? To do that, we've got to have some boundaries, some guides to help us accomplish that. And that's where values come in, all right? Values are vitally important. And so we've got some values that I'm going to share with you. And as I go through some of these, I'm going to address some things right off the front, because I was praying this morning, and I'll tell you at the end of the day, at the end of the message, what God stirred in my heart. But I'm going to address some things that you may or may not like, okay? But I'm going to address them anyway, because I told you what, I'm going to be truthful with you always, and I'm just going to nip it in the bud, all right? That's how we go, all right? And so we have a set of values that will guide our behavior, that will keep us focused on how we manage what God wants to do, okay? So we're going to go down through these values together, one by one. And I told you this is a little different series on how we're going to be that church, but you're going to see why this is vital in just a little bit, okay? First value I want to put up here, all right? We will always keep Christ at the very center of everything we do. If, by some odd chance, there's nothing that we do, I have a phrase, and let me read, I'll just read the phrase. There is nothing that we do that will be more important than Christ being at the center. If Christ is not at the center, we will not allow it, we will not participate in it, or be around it. And I want to take a moment, and I want to address something right here, and I want to get it out there. I have heard and know that you guys have experienced and went through a process where there were folks that were here that wanted to openly and freely speak in tongues inside the sanctuary, inside the church. I told you we were going to talk about things that were going to get you uncomfortable. Does anybody itching yet? Okay. I want to share my heart on this to make sure you understand something. As a church, we do not openly practice tongues here, okay? I am in no way condemning what God wants to do through people. But that gifting and the way that God wants to work through that is between them and their Heavenly Father. There are so many people that come in here on Sunday mornings that they're so new in their relationship with Jesus Christ, they would look at that and not even have a clue. So in a sense, what happens is if you're not careful, people begin to misunderstand it, and all of a sudden they fear it, because you fear what you don't know, right? And so I want to make sure you hear that from me. I'm very clear on this. On Sunday mornings, openly, we will not be having the practice of speaking in tongues here at the church, okay? I just want to go ahead and say it. So I told you guys I was going to make you really uncomfortable. I am not saying that God can't gift you in that way. I'm not saying, listen, I will never put a cap on what God may or may not want to do through or in you. That is not my position. My position is to make sure that whatever takes place here on Sunday mornings shows the lost all about Jesus Christ. And sometimes when the lost walk in here, they have no clue when people are practicing what that is, what that's about, and it causes confusion. And so I want to make sure that I go ahead and address that, okay? I told you guys, some of you are going to throw tomatoes at me. It's okay. I love you. And if you want to get together and talk about that a little bit more in dialogue, let's do that. We don't have time for it here, okay? You just email me and we'll get together for coffee. Number two, we will always focus on the presentation of the gospel, because what we do represents who he is. It should be done with excellence. If it cannot be done with excellence, it will not be done. Okay? Did you hear me? My gosh, you guys are looking at me like I have lost my ever-loving mind. Listen, these are values that are going to drive our behavior to help us achieve the mission that God has us set on. You need to know these. And we got to be on the same page as a family. Number three, we will always be all in for the mission and vision that God has put us on, okay? We will not make any exceptions for anybody or anything who wishes to operate outside of our vision and our mission. We will be all in all the time for the vision and mission that God has us on, okay? Number four, I'm going to pause and talk about something here in a second. It's not going to be comfortable for you. I just want to go ahead and give you a heads up on it, okay? Get ready. All right, here we go. Number four, we will always serve first wherever we are needed. We will serve one another in whatever capacity is needed. There is nothing below us or above us that we will not be willing to do. I will want to pause here and say two things. One, this past Thursday, something really amazing happened to me, and I told them that I would go ahead and announce it. I became an official member of the Holy Folder Club. Those are the people, they put together our bulletins. They accepted me in on Thursday. I mean, it was awesome. Like, it could be right up there with the top two things that have happened to me since I've been here. Amazing, okay? So what I'm trying to say is there's nothing that we're not going to be willing to do. If I come in here and I see dirt on the floor, I'm going to sweep it up. If you come in here and you see dirt on the floor and you want me to sweep it up, I'm going to check your heart. Are we okay with that? The other thing is this. This church has been built in an incredible way on the backs and shoulders of men and women. And I know that I'm about to say something that's going to make some of you extremely uncomfortable. But what God has done, if you go and you look through the scripture and how God uses women, and you look throughout our church, you will see names like Carol Ankrum. You will see names like Audrey Hale. You will see names of women that have had a huge part in this church. I am not here to look at them and say they can't accomplish what God wants for them because they are a woman. I'm addressing that right now. And I know that some of you may not like that. You can come and see me afterwards. That's why I gave you my email up front. Okay, God wants to use each and every one of us in a creative way. We are here as a church to empower whoever it is that God has called. And I want to go one step further. Not only their sex, but their race. I feel like God just put it on my heart. I'm going to say it. I don't care what the color of your skin is. I don't care what, it doesn't matter. If God calls them to step up and help us, we're going to lock arms with them and we're going to move this church forward. Amen? You understand? Okay? This is huge for me. And so I'm just drilling it right now. Okay? I just want to get it out of the way. There's more, I promise. All right? Which one are we on now? Yeah, number five. We will always seek to impact our communities, our country, and our world. We will not remain inside the walls of a building, for no building can contain the love of Christ. How do you think we're doing on that? Don't answer, okay? I'll let you know on week four of the series, okay? Number six. We will always embrace change when souls are at stake. We will change when change is needed. If what we are doing becomes ineffective, we will scrap everything and start over. I hope you're seeing a pattern. The pattern is that there are people that need us, and we've got to be willing to do whatever it is that it takes to get them in love with the Heavenly Father, okay? So sometimes that's going to require some change, okay? That's why that value's in there. Number seven, and here you're going to get mad at me again. Number seven, we will always honor one another over our personal preference. We will be a people where unity exists. If you don't like it, remember, it's not always about you. And I want to pause right here, and I want to talk about the elephant. Not really an elephant. Let's take our music, for example. Okay? I'm just going to say it for what it's worth. Hey, listen, I gave the elders a heads up on this message, so you got to go through them too. There are people here that feel that our music is too loud. That's a personal preference. I feel, as your lead pastor, do you know what I feel? It's not loud enough, okay? I am a 97 to 99 decibel guy, okay? And you really want, can I share with you why that is? It's really nothing more than the fact that I don't want to hear myself sing. I am terrible. I can't sing at all, okay? But I'm using this as an example. My personal preference is that we crank it up, which we've not done. Some people's personal preference is that we take it down, which we've not done. We're going to hit right in the sweet spot. We're going to do our best to keep everybody happy. But guess what? Our personal preference, it's not really about us. Okay? And so I'm just addressing that right off the get-go. That way, my man Josh and whoever's back in the sound booth can sleep at peace tonight. Okay? Knowing that they may not get hammered a little bit. And I want to share that. And I'll show you why it's not about our personal preference at the end of this thing, okay? But I have one more value really quickly. We will always be multiplying rather than maintaining. There is no point in which we will ever stop growing numerically and, more importantly, spiritually. Do you know who has the hardest job here at this church? Do you? Pastor Steve. Getting each and every one of you into a group with Scott, or into our youth, or into our children's, that's not easy. So if you want, you could help them out and jump in. It'd be a lot easier on them. We are going to go deeper spiritually as a church. And we're going to do that first. Now, numerical increases are going to come. God's going to send people, but we're going to be focused. If you're not in a small group right now, I'm in a small group. I've been here 9 weeks, okay? Like, it's not, we've not always made it necessarily easy to get in. Scott's working on that even more. We're trying to build leaders faster because what God's doing here is incredible. We need you to take some steps to help develop your faith. This can't be just about Pastor Steve and Scott and some other folks trying to get you into a group. You should want to be in a group and to take your faith deeper. Okay? I'm just saying that for what it's worth. And then I just want to wrap up with this. And this is where I'm going totally rogue from my notes, because this morning, man, God was all over me. I was actually late to church this morning, just so you guys know. Told you I'd be honest. I was praying and spending some time reading God's word this morning. And I was struggling with how I was going to deliver this today to you guys. And I was realizing that there's really no great way other than me to just say, here it is. And I hope you love me, and I hope you embrace me, and I love you, and I'm going to embrace you. We're going to work through the things together as a church. We're going to work through the difficult times together. But I was struggling coming in today. Like, how, God, why can you give me something? And this morning, I love it, because he did it this morning. If he'd have done it last night, I would have been much happier. But he gave it to me this morning, okay? I was reading in Genesis 16. I'll give you a little bit of background of Genesis 15 through 17. Basically, Abraham, God's going to give him a son. He gets impatient. Well, excuse me, Sarah's like, she can't give him a son that he wants. And so the whole Jerry Springer type thing takes off, if you remember. Sarah's like, hey, you can go ahead and sleep with my slave, Hagar, right? And Abraham's like, okay. And so that happens, and then the baby's born, and all of a sudden as that takes place, Sarah gets jealous, okay? And she starts treating Hagar like pretty bad. And so Hagar, she just takes off. And then the angel of the Lord shows up and begins to speak to her and tells her to go back and to submit and to go. And it was a mess. When I say Jerry Springer, it's like, are the results in type of thing, you know? Like, it was ugly. But I want to share something with you. After the angel of the Lord got done speaking to Hagar, she said this, and this isn't going to be on the screens. I want you to listen to me. It's not on the screens because I got it this morning. Excuse me. Verse 13. She gave this name to the Lord who spoke to her. You are the God who sees me. For she said, I have now seen the one who sees me. And God gave that to me this morning. I need to take a drink before I choke up even more. And I realized something. I've always said, you know, it's not about me, but there's still somewhat at times been a part where I just want it to be about me a little bit. And what I realized when I was reading that this morning is it's truly not about me. Because you see, what she said there was he sees me. Hagar is in a mess. And God sees her. And she sees him. And it's beautiful. Fast forward to today. I've said some things that have made you uncomfortable. I've shared with you how we're going to operate together as a church. And I know that there are some of you in here, you might feel pretty frustrated or like, man, I don't know. I want to share this with you. There are people in this city
and in this county and in this state that need to know that God sees them. And God's plan for that to happen is through you and me. So when I say we've got to get better at managing what God has blessed us with, we all need to be on the same page. Now you know why. Because it's not about us. It's about what he wants to do through us. And if we're all not on the same page, he can't reach. He can't get. We have a lot of teachers in here, and they see students day in and day out, and their hearts break because that student, their home life is a wreck. Listen, there are people that you go to work with right now that have no idea who God is. There are people that you're going to see at Walmart that have no clue that God sees them where they are. There are people last night, I guarantee you, there was someone in this town last night that probably had a gun to their head or a bottle of pills that was willing to take their life because they don't think that God sees them. So far be it for me and you to not be on the same page and allow God to use us to go change that life. You see, Hagar, when she said that, and I was reading that this morning, my heart got full. And I'm like, God, we're going to do the hard things. And you're right, I am going to talk about some difficult things today. It was almost a confirmation of, hey, we've got to do this as a family right now. We've got to all be on the same page because it's not about us. It's about who's out there and what God wants to do through us. And it doesn't matter if you're a man. It doesn't matter if you're a woman. It doesn't matter the color of your skin. It doesn't matter any. What it matters is that you're willing to allow God to work in and through you to change this community for him. That's what this church will be about. So, if as I've went, you've had some things where you're like, I don't like that, I don't like this, you need to check your heart. And you need to ask yourself, is this about you? Or is this about what God wants to do through you? Because I had my heart checked this morning. This is about the Father. And so as we go, and we begin to look at being that church, I knew we couldn't look over the next 3 weeks at being that church without having this family meeting today and letting you know my heart, that I love each and every one of you. I care for you deeply. But sometimes we're not all going to get along, but we're going to address it and we're going to move forward. Know that my heart is for you, but most of all, it's for what God wants to do through you. So I hope today you now know a little bit more about me. And I'm sorry in advance, but this is what God wanted me to share. I know it hasn't been the most eloquent sermon, I know, but I knew what God needed to go ahead and deliver to us as a family. And here's the thing. We need each and every one of you. God needs you. Young, old, doesn't matter. God's got a purpose for you. And as we go over the next 3 weeks, you're going to begin to see how your purpose can make a difference in this community. Amen? Amen? Would you pray with me? Father God, I am so thankful, Lord. God, these family meetings, these getting on the same page meetings aren't always necessarily the easiest. God, open our hearts. Because this is about you and what you want to do through us. So God, as we embrace the steps going forward, I pray that you would help us to remain in a place of humility. God, that if something bothers us, that we will come to one another rather than to go to 10 other people. God, help us to draw closer as a family and help us to begin this change, this city, this county, this state, this country, this world. God, so many people back in the day never saw the miracles coming that you wanted to do. And I imagine right now, God, there are many of us sitting here praying, and we have no idea what it is that you want to do through us right here in Manchester. let us be obedient. Let our hearts be open to what you want to do through us. We love you and we thank you, God. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. I want to go ahead and just commend you for not throwing a tomato. And I know that this hasn't necessarily been the easiest thing, but it's needed. We have to be on the same page if we're going to make a difference in this community, in this county, in this world, okay? And so it's huge for me. And I just wanted you to hear my heart. If you guys, again, if you have any questions, you want to get together for coffee and talk about anything that I've said, I want to invite you to do that with me. If there's like 50 of you, you might have to give me a week or two to get to you, okay? Either that or I'll just set up shop at Aunt Emmy's for like 3 days in a row and y'all just filter in one at a time. We'll do that, you know, the BMV take a number system thing. But anyway, there's a lot of amazing things going on here at Cornerstone. And so for more on that, I want you to do me a favor and check out this video that we have of our friend Marcus.
Hey, this is Marcus. Here's a few things happening here at Cornerstone. We're having a gift card drive. We're collecting gift cards as a way to bless families in need. If you have any gift cards that you collected over the holidays and would like to donate them, they can be dropped off at the Next Steps booth. Baby dedications. January 20th is the Sanctity of Life Sunday. We'll be holding our next baby dedication on that date. If you would like to dedicate your child on that day, please sign up at the Next Steps booth. Women's Night will be held January 22nd from 6:30 to 8 in the Iowa Room. The focus will be on believing our identity in Christ. Please bring your Bibles and a snack to share. New group experiences. This Sunday the 6th, we have a new marriage group experience starting upstairs during second service. You and Me Forever by Francis and Lisa Chan. Also, a reminder, we have a new women's study and parenting study happening as well. See the bulletin for the times and location for these groups. For more information on the parenting study, check out this video.
We want our children to succeed. We want them to be all that they can be. We want them to maximize their potential, and whatever it is, we want them to go further than we went, and we want them to reach the top. But if you go downtown and you look at a skyscraper, the higher that building went up, the deeper they drilled down. Because it's hard to build a skyscraper on the foundation of a chicken coop. We have a generation of parents who want their kids to have skyscraper potential on a chicken coop spiritual foundation.
I'd like to go ahead and invite the ushers and pray for our offering. One thing that you can know that this is not about you in the way is the giving. It's an obedient act to God, and it tells you that this is not about you. So hey, let's pray for that. If you'd like to give through technology, you can text CCC people to 77977. Let's pray. God, thank you for giving us this message, and for us to know that it's not about us, it's about what you want to do through us, and we're so grateful for that. Bless these offerings, bless what you're doing through them. We love you in Jesus' name, amen. stood before creation. Eternity in your hand. You spoke the earth into motion. My soul now to stand. You stood before my failure and carried the cross for my shame. My sin weighed upon your shoulders, my soul now to stand. So what could I say? What could I do? But offer this heart, oh God, completely to you. So I'll walk upon salvation. With arms high and heart abandoned, in awe of the one who gave it all, I'll stand my soul, Lord, to you surrendered all. I am is yours. Come on, let's raise our hands to our God as one family. And I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned, in awe of the one who gave it all, I'll stand my soul, Lord, to you surrendered all. I am his yours. I'll stand
with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand my soul, Lord, to you surrendered all. I am, it's yours, yeah. And I'll stand with arms high and heart abandoned in awe of the one who gave it all. I'll stand my soul, Lord, to you surrendered all. I am, it's yours.
Awesome week. We'll see you back here next weekend for part two of We Are That Church. You guys have a great week.
Our God, a mighty warrior, you're a consuming fire. In victory you triumph in your name, Jesus the great commander. You conquered death forever. In victory you reign. We triumph in your name, our God, a mighty warrior. You're all consuming fire. In victory you reign. We triumph in your name, Jesus the great commander. You conquered death forever.